Welcome to Aurora IAS channel, and today we'll be discussing about the corporate governance portion. So let's begin this discussion, where the genesis of the topic has taken place from the 1990s Bank of Credit and Commerce International. There was a bank in the UK which ruined, which ran into bankruptcy, and there was a committee, Cadbury committee, appointed in that period in 1991. Estimated what were the reasons for the bankruptcy. The major reason and why it led to the bankruptcy was identified as a corporate governance. What is corporate governance? Before that, we need to understand the structure of the corporate structure, the corporate structure itself in any kind of a company. The basic thing is that in the middle of the portion of this flowchart, you could see the board of directors holding the very key position. They will appoint the risk committee, audit committee. As shareholders, shareholders are people like you and me who will buy the shares in the company. We will appoint a shareholders auditor, and this auditor will cooperate with the auditor committee established by the board of directors, will audit the company's credits and debits every now and then. And then this board of directors also will appoint the corporate governance committees, as well as human resource committees, or the other kind of management issues will be dealt with all these committees for the well-being of the organizational structure as a whole, for the well-being of the company. So this is the whole view of how the board of directors and creditors, shareholders work on. Let's go into the actual definition of corporate governance. It says that it is the rules and practices, like the processes, same like just the government will utilize some e-governance, some public service delivery, some kind of bank mitras. So all these are kind of a functionaries where they're using it to make the public service delivery an easiest form of mode of governance. So the same governance in the corporate sector, in the private sector, is known as a corporate governance. They use the rules, practices and processes. The company is directed and controlled, involving the balancing the interest of the company stakeholders, like the management, like the shareholders, the customers, as well as their own organization as well. So there is a right balance of the interest for which the company will be having a brand image in the society, as well as it will also encompass a management from action plans to control the performance, measurement and corporate disclosure. It will, every time you must have heard, there is an annual meeting for SBI, there will be annual meetings even for a corporate banks. For at least per a year, they'll meet at least for one time, and all the members of the cooperatives or the regional banks or the India level banks also will call you for their corporate meetings, like annual meetings, board meetings. But the only thing is that we try to neglect it. But you have to ensure that when you go to that meetings, you will understand where the bank's position is being there in the chart of the economy, and how is it performing, and how you can reap the benefits from the bank, and all the these kind of an economic issues will be dealt in those meetings. So you should go to these meetings. For the coming back to the corporate governance upholds the principles of transparency, integrity, ethics and honesty. What will happen? How is this ensured? See, now you are a shareholder. You want to get the information like, is your share increasing or decreasing? What are the business practices the company is into that is leading for your share increase or decrease? You as a shareholder, you have a right. Just like a consumer, you have a consumer rights. The same way, as a shareholder, you have also the shareholder rights to ask for a company's details. And how ethical the company is to give you the transparent information is a questionable thing. That is why the corporate governance plays a very important role. It will have the best management practices, compliance the laws and in letters and spirit, and adhere to the ethical standards of distribution of wealth and discharge the social responsibility. How it will discharge the social responsibility? One is through the stakeholders. One is through the customers. One is to the shareholders. All these three play a very vital role. Apart from this, they have a greater responsibility through the corporate social responsibility. It is nothing but for your past 3 years, whatever net profit you gain from the company's activities, of that 2% has to be given back to the society, because you have utilized the natural resources of the society, you have utilized many other issues. That is the reason you have an obligation towards the society as a responsibility. So that is a very important ethical aspect. The next one is, Why the corporate governance is so important? We need to mitigate the risk and compliance. What has happened in recent times, you have seen the very recent example is to that of the ILFS crisis. What happened in the ILFS crisis? This is a non-banking finance corporation that went into losses about 3,800 crores. It will finance all the industrial giants, companies, and when they turn their back to this NBFCs, that is where the crisis is occurring. They didn't give back the loans they have taken. They didn't pay the interest on the time. As such, the ILFS, in order to not bring out this issue outside, they have again evergreen their loans. They have given again loans to repay back the old loans of these companies, which is a very, very crucial issue to understand, because this is ethically wrong, as well as a business practice, this shouldn't have occurred. And then you have given a loan and again they have bankrupted. This is how the crisis have got up to an extent that we are at a loss of 3,800 crores, which is equal to a project of a space, which is in fact equal to projects of like 10 times the projects at ISRO can be made with this kind of a money. So you understand the gravity of the issue. There have been Sharda schemes. There have been many other issues like UTI scam that went on, Ketan Parekh, insider trading issues. All these are interlinked to this corporate governance. It's very important that we have to comply to this corporate governance for a better business practices that can balance the interest at every level. Then we have the enhancing the shareholders value. Enhancing the shareholder value is nothing but maximize the interest of all the stakeholders, value each one of them as a single entity, yet a very crucial one, and so that you can have a better image during even the economic downturns. That is why corporate governance is important. Improved organizational efficiency for better utilization of resources with some kind of an innovation steps. Then there is a crucial, corporate governance is crucial during the mergers and acquisitions. It can differentiate between a good deal and a bad deal when you have a good corporate governance structure at hand. Then there is most importantly, globalization. After the 1991, these kind of an issues of corporate mishappenings are being occurring, like the Satyam scam, Sharda Chitfund scam, UTI, Ketan Parekh, Harshad Mehta scam. All these scams have the root of the origin is that in the globalization, the desire of a company to get into the international stock exchange list, no matter whichever practices they want, that is driving them to do all these kinds of an unethical practices. To put an end to it, in a globalization, you need to understand that only when you have a good image in your own country with the kind of responsibility you have in your own motherland, only then you can gain that spot in the international stock exchange. Okay, with manipulation, you might end up only with a scam, but not more than that. So the next thing is that some facts regarding this, but moreover, not the facts, but last point of this slide is very important, that the Forbes magazine partners with Statista to release a magazine based on which the rankings of the companies are derived. These rankings are totally derived based on the social conduct, trustworthiness of the company, performance of the company's service, and company as an employer. So you see, all these issues are ethical in nature. Employment, service products, performance, trustworthiness, all this. So this is the aspect which we have to focus on this particular lecture, because this lecture series is about ethics, integrity and aptitude. This concept is also there in your GS paper 2 governance portion, where you will study a total different approach there, while here you have to see this concept from the ethical angle. So the OECD gives us some principles, legal ethical principles based on which the corporate governance works on. It is about the rights of the shareholders, equitable treatment of the shareholders, role of stakeholders in corporate governance, disclosure and transparency, and responsibilities of the board. So what it does is, you have to have for a sustainable development for all, you have to consider every other stakeholders as single entity, an important entity in any business practice. Next, it says that effective management and distribution of wealth has to be there. Where remuneration pays, even now, there is a gender inequity, gender diversity, gender disparity of the remuneration being paid at the corporate level. So that is where effective management and distribution of wealth is failing. But this is a very important principle for a corporate governance. Then we have a discharge of social responsibility. The social responsibility is corporate social responsibility. We have been listening to this CAG reports and many other reports that the social responsibility fund is being not utilized to an extent, and all the funds are being diverted to somewhere else, and profits the company are making is not being distributed into the society. And then we have the best management practices application with the compliance to the law in letter and spirit with adherence to the ethical standard. These forms the basic important principles regarding the ethical values principles regarding the corporate governance. So this has been taken from a company's corporate governance framework, where they mention that we manage as a trustee, as a stakeholder relationship, we have a corporate structure, as well as a transparent and in letter and spirit, we follow everything. So just have a look about it. This will form a diagram as well as your content for this chapter as well. All of these are the business practices, ethical business practices. So the next one is, this has been taken from the Infosys company's annual board meetings folder, where they mention the ethical values in the corporate governance, what the Infosys people follow. So it is very important to have a board as a trustee. Board as a trustee, the Gandhiji also has re-emphasized always that what trusteeship means, because this company is acting as a safeguarding the shareholders' capital as a trustee is an important ethical principle. Then integrity and transparency to maintain a high level of integrity. What you say and what you think, what you do should all align in the same line. Then is a legal compliance of the letter and spirit of following the law of the land. Then we have the relationship with all the stakeholders. Communicate with the stakeholders frequently through the annual meetings, through the board meetings, that what is going wrong, and raise a red flag whenever there is a crisis, so that early arrival on the solution for the crisis is better than later repenting after a scam or after the bankruptcy of the company. Okay, then there is a fairness and excellence. The fair is to deliver. The corporate governance importance in India is important because for a higher level of confidence among the shareholders to have a positive outlook of the company, as well as the transparency increasing in case of insider trading rules being broken, as well as the functions of audit and finances should have an ethical, moral and legal dimensions have to be practiced in the business, as well as finally for the economic progress of the country, this corporate governance plays a very important role. Let's see the statutory framework India placed for a good governance. One is the Companies Act of 1956, which says that there have been many amendments later. That is important because the previous one, it is of 1956. At that point of time, India was not in a very good structure of having a good structure of corporate. So the 2013 plays a crucial aspect. We'll see about the Indian Companies Act 2013. It says that you have to increase the shareholders from 50 to 200, you have a liability under the corporate social responsibility. It has said that 2% of your previous 3 years annual profit you have to give to the society in form of CSR. As well as the women empowerment in the corporate sector has to be encouraged, make them a part of your board of directors. As well as the company law and tribunal and law appellate tribunal has to be established to have a grievance redressal mechanism, as well as resolving the conflicts. Then comes the Companies Amendment Bill 2017, which deals with the ease of doing process, harmonize the accounting standards according to the Act of Securities and Exchange Board of India, and with regarding to the Reserve Bank of India Act of 1934. Then comes the regulatory framework. We have seen till now the legislative framework. Now with the regulatory framework, regulating is that a kind of an auditor
who regulates your activities, or like the CAG, which regulates the activities of the government expenditure. The same way, regulatory framework for the corporate governance has been established through SEBI. SEBI is like, it is extending to all the jurisdiction of the listed companies through the regulations, rules and guidelines to the companies to ensure the protection of the investors. Then we have a standard listing agreement of stock exchanges for the companies where the shares are listed. And then the accounting standards issued by the ICAI for disclosures of the financial information, ICSI for the standards, secretarial standards in terms of the provisions of New Companies Act. So based on these frameworks, there have been various committees timely established by the government. First one is the Rahul Bajaj Committee of 1995. He gave a voluntary code, kind of a desirable corporate governance in 1998 itself. This is a code for the corporate structure to follow the ethical, legal and moral rules. And then the very famous Kumar Mangalam Birla Committee report in 2000. It said that protection of the investor interest, promotion of a transparency, building the international standards to disclose the information of the company to the shareholders and stakeholders is an important role. Based on which the SEMI has incorporated a clause of 49 in its act. There is another Naresh Chandra Committee report which has been given in 2000 and that period of time. It says that you need to have an auditor company should have a extensive relationship, because the auditor is the one who is regulating your companies. It shouldn't manipulate, but it should regulate. It should tell you like what measures you have to take for a better enhancement of the management, rather than finding the loopholes in the legal law. And then we have the Narayan Murthy Committee in 2003, which says that the corporate governance and recommendations have been given more or less the same thing with some extension points have been given by the Udhav Kotak panel committee. So this is a very important panel of the recent times. So this panel says that the chairperson of the listed committee should be a non-executive director, should be independent in managing the company's affairs, and they increase the meetings to 5 in a year. Every board meeting should be in presence of the independent director, as well as the independent director's number should be increased. This way, the transparency or accountability is enhanced. An audit committee will also be proposed to mandate to look into the utilization of funds by the company, as well as the SEBI recommendations. It said that SEBI should give out some recommendations of clear powers to act against the auditors and the under the Security Laws Tribunal Act. So these are the some of the important recommendations of the panel. The basic thing is that since this is a subject of ethics, you need to regard the subject in that point of view. You have to write your answers in that respect. When the case study comes, or for the matter, any kind of a question comes, they will not ask you like what Uday panel committee has said. Even if you know the 2-3 points of a committee, that would suffice your answer. The main important thing you need to know is the ethical values which have been violated or which is important in these kinds of issue. First one is that in remuneration, you need to have a gender equity. Then in transparency and accountability, you should have no room for the nepotism. For the board of directors or the independent directorates, when they ask that women have to be into the board of directors list, it is not your kith and kin you have to promote to these positions. You have to take the independent people from the outside boundary who is not associated with your family should be the members, so that there is a transparency in the process. There should be self-management and self-regulation in the board itself, so that all the miscrepancies that happen should not be happening in the company, for a better image, for a better compliance of the standards, ethical standards. There should be integrity in the managerial competencies. What you tell through your annual meetings should be shown in your actions. If you say you're promoting the corporate social responsibility with 2% of the funds, you need to show up with your activities. Then there is a trustworthiness and brand image, important aspect of ethical understanding of the corporate governance issue. The trustworthy, when it is lost, you cannot regain it back that easily. Having an empire like the Tatas is a very good example of the trustworthiness. and the brand image they have. No matter whichever sector they are catering to, their principles, their obedience to laws, their ethical standards, their business practices are exemplary. That you can also quote in your answers, as well as resolve the conflict in management. Whenever the labor issues strive out, like the Maruti, it happened in the case of the Marutis, that kind of an issue should not prolong, and this decreases the trustworthiness in the corporate sector, in between the people managing the in the board of directors, as well as the labor who work for the company. And then we have the shareholders' activism as the role of NGOs and the civil society. We are seeing, in fact, in the society, the same way shareholders' activism plays a very important role. As independent directors, we have to strive hard to bring out the transparency rules and regulations to be abided by, and blow the whistle, the raise the red flag before any crisis deteriorates. Before that, when you raise the red flag, that is when the issue can be solved. So this is all for it, the corporate governance issue. Let's see some answer writing questions for practice. What is the significance of corporate governance, and list out some important steps in direction of the government of India in this direction. What role civil society plays in ensuring the good governance role, and discuss the challenges being faced by the civil service, civil society organization in this scenario. And then we have the corporate morality ethics are now merely a question of exploiting loopholes in the legal framework. Examine the statement in the framework of the corporate governance. For all these three questions, we have enough dealt with in the previous slides itself. So you can have a hold on it and write some good answers in 150 words and post it and comment it below, so that we'll review your answers. So that's it. Hope you have. So for answer writing questions for practice are these two. Write down these answers in the comment section below, so that we can review it. What is the significance of the good corporate governance? List out some of the important steps taken by the government of India in this direction. As well as then another question, like, corporate morality and ethics are now merely a question of exploiting the loopholes in the legal framework. So examine the statement in the framework of the corporate governance. In the ethical perspective, please write down some 150 words each of the answer. So that is it for this session. Hope you are enjoying the series. Keep liking, sharing and subscribing to the channel. And happy learning, guys. Jai Hind.